Hey there guys, welcome back for another presentation in your World Regional Geography course. For this presentation, we're going to introduce the world. Well, let's get going. So to begin, we need to introduce what is geography? Well, geography is a discipline that bridges the social with the physical sciences, things such as geomorphology and social sciences. Geomorphology is learning how the Earth is changing and how we can study that. And social sciences deal more with people and culture. Now, there are ways the world are viewed geographically in this course. We'll be looking at a little bit of what is known as spatial analysis of both nature and human cultures. We'll be looking a little bit at the Earth sciences. We'll also look at area studies. And we'll look at human-landscape interactions. Now, the diagram on the right is something that I thought was important because sometimes think that geography is just about states and capitals, which that does include it. But we find that geography as a term is a really broad term. And I like it because what it does is it puts the phrases or the terms of geography, the language that we use, in the middle and what you might say on the outside. So perhaps you are studying anthropology or sociology. Well, I would call it cultural geography, or maybe you're studying history. I would look at it as historical geography. Maybe you look at urban planning. Well, I would call it urban geography. So we're able to observe that geography is really about spatial place and people. And that's what welcomes us to this course, is that we're going to learn about the different realms throughout this world and look a little bit at the people, the language, the religion. We're going to look a little bit at the population densities and the overall topography and see how that all relates within its culture. Well, the first thing we have to mention is some of the basics. We understand that we have a grid system that has been oriented based off of lines of latitude and longitude. If you need a little more help with this, I've tagged a video right here to make sure you can check that out. But otherwise, if we're able to move forward, latitude are lines that go this way, they wrap all the way around the world, they're parallel, they'll never touch, and they're discs, they're circular, right? And longitude intersect at the north and the south poles, and they're half of great circles. Well, because of those lines of longitude, we're able to identify time zones, which we'll address later in this course. We also know the Earth is tilted, and because of that tilt, it actually changes the effect of intensity and duration of the sun's energy that is being absorbed along the Earth's surface. That, in tune, can affect our weather and long-term data known as climate. That being said, we will be making reference to the Köppen climate classification, specifically just at the major categories. So we'll be making reference throughout the rest of this course as climates that might be of A, B, C, D, E, or H. So as you can see below, an A climate, A-type climate, would be tropical or equatorial. A B-type climate is dry or arid. C-type climate is moderate or temperate, which is, I live in Santa Clarita, and so we are a C-type climate. Then you have D, which is cold and continental, E, which is polar and extreme, and H, which is going to be your highlands. The images to the right, I have provided for you one showing the tilt of the Earth, special lines of latitude that have been distinguished and identified based on seasonal change. Again, if you need help with that, there's a video shared here as well for another lecture in case you would like to know a little bit more about that. And then the image down below is identifying our seasons, when they occur, and looking at the tilt of the Earth and its direction towards the sun. We find that during the equinox, everything is equal. Every line of latitude gets equal amount of daylight and darkness. But we find that during the solstices, like the summer solstice in particular, that's June 20 to 21st, we find that the northern hemisphere is tilted closer towards the sun. So we have longer days and shorter nights. While during the winter solstice, December 21st to 22nd, we find that the northern hemisphere is tilted away from the sun. So we have longer days, and we have... we don't... we have longer nights, and we're going to have shorter days. So let's move forward. This diagram here shows just the global distribution of the Köppen climate classification that was mentioned in the previous slide. Things that we can reference here, we can see that there are relationships and things that correlate based on latitude. We can look at the topography and see how large mountain ranges can affect our weather and climate within our system. We find that orographic lift and the rain shadow effect can certainly play larger roles on a region's climate. We also then, again, as I mentioned before, we can look at the latitude and see how that plays an effect as well. Now, we'll look at world population. Now, demography is the study of how human population changes throughout time. Now, as families transition from agriculture to industrial economies, there is an observed shift in family size. When you have a family that is more agricultural or rural-based, families tend to be larger. When you move into a cityscape, families tend to be smaller. And think about that. Why do you think that plays an effect? Now, at the beginning of the 20th century, the Earth had a population of about 1.6 billion. Today, we're exceeding 7.6 billion people. That's really, really impressive as to how fast that's grown. In fact, we are concerned that we might be overpopulating because we do have a limited amount of resources that are being consumed by us. Now, there are an estimated 6,500 living languages. Yet, we do see a decline. In fact, we have seen some 400 languages disappear just in the past few years. Now, there are 9 dominant language families in the world. Each of the languages within a language family will share a common ancestral language. So what I've shown here are 2 maps. The one on the top is showing cities with at least 1 million people in population, dating from 2006. And the map below is looking specifically at the major language families. We can see Indo-European, we can see Niger-Congo, all kinds of different languages. And within those, we can see that, you know, speaking of language, we have our dominant 9 families, but then we have variations of each family. Think about just your dialect. A dialect is that variation in your dominant language. So, living in Southern California, let's take it back. Living in the United States, we know that a majority of the people speak English, but there's different styles of English. Someone who lives in Georgia versus San Diego versus Montana. All English, but different variations or dialects. And so that also kind of, you know, creates this exciting piece of linguistics where we get to study how different language can be within a realm. Now, looking at religion, a lot of information here, but I'm going to kind of just skip through it. So Christianity and Islam originated out of Judaism in the Eastern Mediterranean and the Arabian Peninsula. Both are monotheistic religions that look to the Jewish patriarch Abraham as a founding personage. Now, Christianity is based on the life and teachings of Jesus Christ, who lived in Palestine in the first century. Now, that religion spread rapidly throughout the Roman Empire. Islam is based on the teachings of Muhammad, a 7th century religious and political figure who lived in the Arabian Peninsula. Islam spread rapidly across North Africa, east across Southern Asia, and north to Europe in the centuries after Muhammad's death. Now, Buddhism is another religion, or a way of life based on the teachings of the life of Siddhartha Gautama, who lived in what is now India or Nepal around the 5th century. There are 3 main branches of Buddhism. There's the Southern, there's the Eastern, and the Northern version of Buddhism. Now, Hinduism, a religion tradition that originated on the Indian subcontinent, is one of the oldest major religions still practiced in the world, and it dates back as far as 2000 BC, or maybe even earlier. Now, unlike other world religions, Hinduism has no single founder and is a conglomerate of diverse beliefs and traditions. Now, as we can see remaining, you also have schism, you have Judaism, you have Shintoism and Confucianism. Those are all different types of world religions that we observe in our landscape. And remember, just like language, you have these dominant forms of religion, and then you're going to have a diversified, adapted type of religion for each realm. So you'll have different types of Christianity, different types of practiced Buddhism, different types and variations and interpretations of Islam. So that also is something that we will take a look at this semester. Now, the world realms, there's lots of realms that we're going to be discussing this term. So the world itself, we see that it's broken up into Europe, which is Eastern Europe and Western Europe. There's also the Russian realm. There's the Americas, so you have North America, Middle America, and South America. We're also going to introduce North Africa and the Middle East. We're going to talk about Sub-Saharan Africa. We're going to be talking about Southern Asia, Eastern Asia, Southeast Asia, Australia, and the Pacific. So the way this course is really designed is within chunking those realms together. So as we progress throughout our lectures, you'll see that in one module, all the Americas are pushed together, and we're going to separate it apart within that context. But this is the way that we're going to observe this world, is within these realms. We're going to, again, as I mentioned before, we're going to discuss the people, the language, the population density. We're going to talk about some of the culture and some of the overall history and the topography, meaning the landscape of these realms. We'll find that certainly plays a role on agriculture. We will be mentioning agriculture in every single one of these realms because that is a driving force for economy for many of these locations, which is really interesting knowing how limited those resources such as water and fertile land might be. So each one of these videos is going to have a tested option where we're going to go over four quick questions that will be found within the reading and within these videos. So the first question is, it is observed that as people shift from agriculture to industrial, what happens to family sizes? The next question, globally, there are at least how many different spoken languages? Third question, there are thousands of religion variations, but geographers recognize how many types of religion? And question four, European colonialism created a major wave of globalization, and that extended until when? So again, these questions, make sure you have your little answer form. I'll share them in a moment. In the meantime, take a moment, like this video, make sure you're subscribed, and let's talk about these answers. So it is observed that as people shift from agriculture to industrial, the family sizes will decrease. Now, globally, there are at least how many different spoken languages? Over 6,000 that are actively spoken. Now, there are thousands of religion variations, but geographers recognize how many types of religions. There are actually three types of religions. There's universal, ethnic, and traditional. And then beyond that, we can talk about what religions fit within each one of those. European colonialism created a major wave of globalization, and that actually didn't come until an end until the end of World War II. I hope this was helpful. Welcome to this course. I hope you find the rest of the videos as exciting as this one. And if you need anything, let me know. Otherwise, we'll talk soon.